Dear colleagues, good morning. Let's start the first session of today. And the first paper will be the paper of Andrzej Wypustek of the University of Wrocław, which the title is Between Crime and Accident, a Criminal Investigation into the Funerary Epigram from Arkesine, Amorgos. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. My talk will deal with one of the most interesting funerary epigrams I had the pleasure to translate on my way to a larger study of Greek, ancient Greek funerary poetry. The poem, the epigram, is included in a standard collection by Werner Peck, Griechische Versenschriften, number 1155. But before we will have a look at the text itself, we will start with some. With some background information about Greek sport. In one of the recent studies of Greek pentathlon, in a study by Zarnowski, we can read a statement that during ancient Greek javelin competition, there were no accidents. And this was because javelins, Greek javelins, they were blunt, they were perhaps tapered, but they didn't have a bronze point. With all due respect, I am pretty sure that Zarnowski is wrong on both points, and I hope I will demonstrate this to you on the way. Yeah, these are the crucial citations. The epigram I'm talking about, the epigram comes from a beautiful Greek island, Amorgos, easternmost of Greek islands, Cyclades. The city of Arkesine is located on the western part of the island. There were two more cities on Amorgos, a city of Minoa in the central part and a city of Aigiali in the north. This is the landscape of the island. But just by the way, the island of Amorgos is, one may say, a sacrosanct land of Greek epigraphy. Probably the oldest of all Greek funerary poems comes from this very island, the so-called Deidamas inscription, rock inscription. And still, on the island, as you can see on this photo, the archaeologists, epigraphers, they still do find, year after year, new interesting texts. Sometimes they discover them, like here on the right, removing a cement from the medieval chapel, and under the cement they find a Greek funerary stele with an epitaph. So plenty of very interesting funerary epigrams from come from Amorgos, and this is the location. This is the territory of ancient Arkesine. The city has not been excavated, so we know very, very little. Basically, bits and pieces we have by, more or less by accident. no information about Arkesine, almost no information in literary sources. So all we know, we owe this to epigraphy and archaeology. So this is the last, and from the opposite point of view, again the location, the texts I will show you, this was found, the text was found in the area of Arkesine, spectacular Arkesine Acropolis. And this is the epigram I'm talking, I'm going to talk about. This is the Greek text, but we will have a look at the translation. My feeling is that probably this wrongful statement by Zagorowski I have shown you at the very beginning of my talk, probably this is the result that this epigram has never been translated into English. So it is just the epigram is known to a few epigraphers or people like me interested in Greek funerary poetry, but not outside this small world. So we will start with, if I can ask you to read the text carefully, because we will talk about some details. Okay, so passerby, you are looking at the one who has carried around his 16 years with pride among the Ephebus. Greatly bemoaned, he went among the dead before finishing up whole of his annual race. Annual race, probably that was something connected with Ephebic education, a part of Ephebic education. For a time of joyous contests of the youth, when he was strutting with his peers, a godless man of violence has turned up from some other city, and in the stadium, with his murderous hand, he has thrown an inescapable spike of a whizzing javelin. Sharp projectile point stuck in the side of him, down to the bone. No one has managed to extract it, no one was able to help. And yet, it has yielded before the strength, with the help of Ares' blade, somehow pulled out of the body. Right away, the blood gushed up. He, namely the martyr, the culprit, he has run away through the deserts of sea deaths, while me, Diotimos of the youth's company, in my homeland Arkesine, after 5 days I was snatched away by wretched Moria. When I have found my way to the baneful abode of the dead, my mother Aristarete bewailed me, and my father, old Sosagoras, full of tears, mourned. For instead of hope of sustenance in his house, he was given grief. As for myself, though, Hermes, my childhood companion, he took me with him and led me to the land of the blessed. So as you can see, this is a rather pretentious poetry of rather, from the purely theological point of view, rather poor poetry, but still, it is a very interesting piece of a Greek funerary poem. There are some intriguing realistic details. For example, probably a failed surgical operation they were trying to conduct on the victim of this, let's say, accident. It was rather an accident. So the blade of Ares, so probably some surgical tool. And another detail is that all this happened in the stadium. And now, of course, we don't know where in Arkesine where the stadium was. The place is still unexcavated. But have a look at some other Greek stadium, of course, stadium in Olympia. This will help us to understand why such accidents, why such tragedies were happening during the epic training. The very shape of a Greek stadium, those who were practicing javelin throw, they had to be really, really careful not to hit people with their projectile. This is the modern standard regular track for javelin throws. By the way, this is the list of modern records, the best javelin throws. So as we can see, it's more or less 100 meters far. So, but please remember that the javelin throw, it was different in antiquity in many, many ways. First, the javelins, they were made of usually of elder, so very light kind of wood. So literally, we have some sources we have some information in the sources. Literally, the javelins, they were just flying in the air. More, the athletes, they were using an instrument called in Greek ankle, in Latin amentum. It was a leather strap. We can see this strap in the left hand of this boy about to throw the javelin. And this is the group of competitors, the group of the competitors in the pentathlon. And we can see that on every each of them is carrying a javelin with this strap, leather strap. This ankle thing probably was very, very important. It's somehow effectively it made hand of a sportsman longer. In fact, and also it was increasing the spin. It was increasing the rotation of the javelin, stabilizing the projectile, and also enabling probably a larger distances for the throws. So it looks like in antiquity the javelin throw could be really dangerous while they were practicing. More, Zagorski in his study, he said that there were no bronze points, but again, he's wrong. This is a clear archaeological testimony. This was found in Nemea, and this is such a bronze tip of a, for sure, we are absolutely sure that was a athletic javelin. Okay, so there were bronze points. By the way, Greek athletes, they were using a leather caps as well, probably to avoid their hair entangling into the leather straps they were using. So as you can see, quite a professional equipment of javelin throwers. So accidents in gymnasiums, on stadiums, they must have been quite often occurrences. Here you have some most notorious deaths by disc in Greek mythology, but even in Rome, we've got in the law of the 12 tablets, we have a law covering such accidents, and probably accidents by javelin throw. Okay, so still in Rome, here what you have, it is funerary poem in Latin this time, and we have a similar case of a young boy killed by accident by a javelin while practicing the sport. But the difference is that probably the poem, the inscription was dedicated by his parents, and they say that the javelin was carelessly thrown, but it was not intended to kill. That is the difference, okay? In the epigram from Arkesine I'm talking about, what we have is that it was his murderous hand. Okay, so we have a clear statement of a guilt, of a purpose, that he was basically murdered by one of the Athens. And now the question, of course, why? How come this perpetrator, he was accused of such a heinous, such a serious crime? This is an intriguing question, the more so that we know, thanks to some literary sources, that the Greeks, they could differentiate between intentional killing and, of course, accident, without the real guilt. In the life of Pericles by Plutarch, we have this famous section about Pericles discussing this the problem of deaths by javelin and who was to be held responsible. Also, we have Antiphon's second tetralogy, so a speech in which we've got the notion of categoria funer accusior appears. So an intentional homicide in these circumstances. Okay, so it looks like there was the idea of unintentional killing, and this guy from Arkesine, he shouldn't be prosecuted, he shouldn't be accused of killing a boy in the stadium. More, the crime scene was in the stadium, so in the gymnasium, probably filled with the friends of the victim. So it just, from the purely criminalistic in purely criminalistic terms, it just doesn't make sense. If you want to kill someone, I mean, you don't go into the crowd of his friends. So it just doesn't make sense. But still, the culprit, he is called in our epigram a godless man of violence, and he has turned up from some other city. The term city, the term used is Tircis. This is important, please consider the fact that Tircis means a fortified house, a walled city, or a tower. Now, let us have a look at some inscriptions from Arkesine, from this little town. There's a number of inscriptions in which foreigners appear, like in this one, where we can read Naxion ton Amorgon Arkesinan oikunton. So it looks like people from Naxos, but also we have mentions of Samians, Milesians, etc. So What we see when we look into the epigraphy of the place, we see a surprisingly cosmopolitan community, which is surprising because Arkesine, probably it was a city of, inhabited perhaps by, I don't know, up to 1,000 people. So it was a really small city. So even this, if we have fragmentary information, still it is telling. One of the most famous inscriptions from Amorgos, from Agiale. Have a look. This is like the inscription telling us about a deacon, a meal in gymnasium, into the memory of one of the deceased young boys. And part in this meal, foreigners take part in this meal, and also the Roma. So it is just not only Arkesine. It looks like other cities were cosmopolitan to a degree as well. So when I was reading this text of the epigram from Arkesine, I was struck by this ambivalence. In reality, what we have is we have gymnasium, stadium in Arkesine filled with locals and foreigners practicing together, okay? But on the other hand, in another line, we can read that the culprit, he has run away through the deserts of sea deaths. Okay, so he didn't want to stay. He didn't want to explain his acts. He just ran away. So I was struck by this contrast between this cosmopolitan dimension of this local community and this, you know, hatred, distrust of locals against this foreigner, this foreign culprit. I was asking myself, and I asked this question if this paper will be published. Why? And to me, the explanation is simple. Among the foreigners, we find in the inscriptions of Arkesine. This is an inscription where we see three men. This is a Amorgos inscription, so for sure we are dealing with foreigners who settled down in the area. And there are three mentions: ek Kretes, meaning a man from Crete, Brioni, so Brionos, and Ertaios. The two last names, there are Cretan names. So it looks like we've got a family or a group of people of Crete. And that would be the explanation for me. The Cretans, they were famous for their piracy. So I would say that, you know, that this reason of distrust and of fear and of hatred, combining with assimilation of those for foreigners. And we've got a number of testimonies dealing with piracy, with a problem of piracy on Amorgos. This is a very famous testimony of pirates landing on Amorgos. But we have also the famous inscription from Arkesine itself, where a woman, Timessa, she is being honored because she has ransomed citizens who were abducted by the pirates. And the last, we will finish with some beautiful landscapes of the island and of the location of our cuisine. My I've paid attention also to archaeological dimension. The island, Amorgos Island, and also in Arkesine, we find a number of pyrgoi, a number of towers, and this is the most famous of these towers, the so-called the castle in Arkesine. It is, this is from an aerial photo, but look at the dimension. I mean, on the left you can see the human figure, and look at the proportion. It is a Hellenistic tower, and in all probability, such towers, their function was clearly defensive. Defensive against whom? Against the pirates. So, to me, this strange funerary epigram with this ambivalence between accepting, assimilating foreigners who practice together with locals in the gymnasium, but still somewhere behind, still there is the fear of aliens, of foreigners threatening this small local community. So that's why this funerary poem is so interesting to me. All I have told you, as you can see, all this, we know this through basically epigraphy and archaeology. So that would be my reconstruction of this crime scene, of this crime setting for this epigram from Arkesine. Thank you very much.